Hi guys, this is gsndown.com and I'm here with a handset called the Allview X2 Xtreme. You may also know it as the Gionee E8. It has been integrated by Romanian device brand Allview as the Allview X2 Xtreme. So this is the Allview flagship for the year 2015. It's a 6-inch quad HD phone. Once again, it's a familiar version of the Gionee E8 integrated locally in Europe. And this device, in case you're wondering, is priced at $562, which is quite good for a quad HD phablet. Since it's a phablet, a 6-inch one, it's big and also pretty massive, as you can see right here, but it's more good looking than its predecessor, the X1 Xtreme, since this is the X2 Xtreme. It's no longer glossy and plasticky, which is a good thing, and it measures 9.6 millimeters in thickness, plus it weighs 204.4 grams. The X1 Xtreme was thicker, it measured 9.7 millimeters, but it was lighter, it weighed 150.5 grams. And I have to say that this model has the same thickness as the HTC One M9, so 9.6 millimeters. It's slimmer than the Nexus 6, which is a plus, and it's about 30 grams heavier than the Asus Zenfone 2, that itself was a pretty heavy phone. Also, it's lighter than the Huawei P8 Max, that's a beast of a phone, that one is a 6.8-incher. Okay, so this model offers a pretty good grip when you're holding it. It's a big phablet with a rounded back, as you can see from its profile and from the lower area to the top. It has a polycarbonate back and a big and strong frame made of a combo of aluminum and magnesium. The color here is what I would call beige and gold combined. And now let's see what the design holds. So at the front we got the earpiece, we got a front camera here, bunch of sensors here, the status LED here, and below the screen we got three capacitive buttons that from what I've seen do not light up in spite of me trying various setups and options. We move to the back, where we find these four holes here associated to a powerful microphone, supposedly, the camera, the dual tone flash, and the fingerprint scanner, plus the speaker here that seems to be pretty big. And now if you remove the back cover made of polycarbonate, this is done in a pretty hard way. Lots of small little flapsies keeping it together. But the key is to remove from the hole first and then start removing them one by one. Okay, so we've made it at last. And below the hood, there is this non-removable battery, two micro SIM card slots and a micro SD right here. And as you can see, there aren't four microphone holes here, only a single hole. Those four were to impress us. And these are the two stereo speakers hidden below this area here. So that's what's under the hood. When you put back the shell, you have to be careful to get all the small clipses back together, otherwise you'll keep hearing this sound quite a few times. Okay, now we proceed with our design analysis. At the top we got the audio jack, at the bottom we got the micro USB port and a microphone. And now let's turn our attention to the sides. Absolutely nothing on the left side, while on the right side we got the volume buttons, pretty slim button here, power button, and a camera button, which is something you don't see very often on an Android phone. These two offer good feedback, however this one here is very slim and a bit flimsy. You don't exactly feel like you're actually pressing it. It doesn't push back, so to say, so not a very good feedback. So keep in mind, a very strong aluminum and magnesium frame, very well built and very solid feeling, pretty good grip here. And this is overall a massive phone. It's a sacrifice worth taking for a 6-incher. That's excellent in movies and games, even if held for long hours like this, perfect for gaming. It's a bit of an advantage, the fact that you don't have those on-screen Android buttons, you gain some screen estate. Obviously, you aren't going to use it with one hand easily because it's quite massive, and there's no point in comparing it to 5-inch phones. So overall, massive, but also a bit classy and quite comfy. Now, as far as the hardware is concerned, we're getting here a 6-inch AMOLED screen with a resolution of 2560 over 1440 pixels. It's also Gorilla Glass 3 protection. And inside, we get a bit of a premiere for us here at gsndown.com, an octa-core MediaTek Helio X10 processor clocked at 2 GHz. We've never tested the Helio X10 device before. It's a 64-bit processor with Cortex A53 cores, and some people also know this CPU as the MediaTek MT6795. Other than that, we get a PowerVR Rogue G6200 GPU, clocked at 700 MHz, 3 GB of RAM, 64 GB of storage, which is quite generous, and a microSD card slot that offers an extra 128 GB. Up front, a megapixel shooter for the selfies, at the back, a huge 24 MP shooter, and on a connectivity side we got LTE with up to 150 Mbps download speed, HSDPA, Bluetooth 4.0, Wi-Fi 802.11 BGNAC, there's Wi-Fi Direct, Wi-Fi display, NFC, micro USB 2.0, and on the sensor side we got an accelerometer, proximity sensor, light sensor, fingerprint scanner and magnetic sensor. In the section we call others, we got stereo speakers with DTS and NXP, you'll see later on what that means. And finally, we've also got the battery. It's a lithium polymer unit with a capacity of 3500 mAh, and it's a jump from the 2500 mAh of the predecessor. The charger is a 200 mAh. On paper, this battery should provide up to 350 hours of standby or up to 720 minutes of functioning time. In our test that involves HD video playback in a loop with Wi-Fi on and brightness of 50%, we achieved 6 hours and 11 minutes, which is a bit below our expectations, especially for such a massive phone. We scored below the Galaxy Note 4 and Nexus 6, both with 8 hours and a half, and also below the predecessor, the X1 Xtreme, that had 8 hours and 21 minutes. At least we managed to beat the HTC One M9 that scored 6 hours and 9 minutes. We beat it by 2 minutes and a few seconds. We also beat the Huawei P8 Lite with its 5 hours and 25 minutes and the M Star S700 with its 5 hours and 55 minutes. Frankly speaking, I expected more from this massive phablet. It may be the fault of the Quad HD screen. We also did a PC Mark test, which tests the device with continuous usage patterns. Here we scored 5 hours and 37 minutes, which is quite reasonable. We beat the Huawei P8 that scored 5 hours and 31 minutes and the Xiaomi Mi 4i that scored 5 hours and 29 minutes. Also we beat the LG G4, it is 5 hours and 19 minutes. We got beaten by the Asus Zenfone 2 with 5 hours and 45 minutes, LG AKA 6 hours and 22 minutes, and Huawei Mate S, we recently tested it, 6 hours and 26 minutes. In my experience of day-to-day use, I got about 1 day, or if I was a cheapskate with the battery, 1.5 days of regular usage. The charging is a bit long here, 2 hours and 44 minutes. It's okay for such a massive device, and a 2-minute improvement from the predecessor. Also, it charges faster than the HTC Desire 120 that requires 2 hours and 57 minutes to charge, or the Huawei P8 with its 2 hours and 47 minutes. Of course, there are many models out there that are charging faster than this one. We got HTC One M8, 2 hours and 30 minutes, Nexus 6, 1 hour and 50 minutes, and some phones that charge in a bit over an hour. Overall, I expected more from the battery, or at least more than the predecessor, but didn't get it, probably on account of the display. Now, if we go into the settings area, we obviously have some power saving features, and we go to power management. We got a power manager here, and 3 main modes: none, no power optimization. There is normal mode that is able to use a dark theme, turn off the GPS, turn off background apps. All the details are shown here. You opt for a dark theme and you start cutting up on synchronization, GPS, Bluetooth and other things. And then there is the extreme mode. Basically, you can only use basic features: phone, contacts, messaging and clock, and a black and white interface, and Allview promises that this will extend your battery life tenfold. That sounds pretty impressive. Now, if you go into the options, you can see that we also have intelligent power saving at night and intelligent memory cleanup, so you can reduce power consumption with a clean background, clean of applications that are being vampires with this battery. Other than that, we also have the standby intelligent power saving, which I've seen on many other devices, and a few other features here related to the aesthetics of the battery. Once again, I expected a bit more from the battery. Now, as far as the acoustics go, you just saw earlier that below this hood, there are 2 stereo speakers. We got an NXP amplifier, a DTS system, and those 2 have special acoustic chambers dedicated. So, I expect great things here. Now, the player, the music player, of this integrated Gionee E8 handset is either play music or an app called Music with a very intuitive and minimalistic interface. And in the More area, you can find common settings like shake to change song, keep screen on, headset key control, or the equalizer that includes DTS with options dedicated more to headsets rather than regular usage, but also regular usage, and the effects volume area. Here we have presets related to musical genres like classic, dance, folk, jazz, and also user-defined options. You can tweak your experience using those 5 channels with sliders, so you can change the way the sound is heard. Back to the device adapter, as I said before, DTS is here and offers various tweaks for various headphones and other means of output. Okay, and we also have a theme option here that you can change for the player. Got Bluetooth play, and now it's time to actually listen to some tunes. Let's start with this one here. Okay, now some conclusions. Pretty loud volume, clear sound, very good high notes, especially the guitar and keyboards, an okay bass, and options here will include the sleep timer, media info, the settings you saw before, and of course we can activate DTS. Let's see what happens. So regular song. As you can hear, it's a bit deeper with more bass and more growl, so to say. And once you insert the headphones, things totally change, new options appear. So the headphones are these ones, which I'm going to discuss just seconds later. Okay, so attaching the headphones and instantly new options will pop up. Select the device, not from here, but rather from here. And you can choose standard headset or go with custom. And in custom mode, you have some extra settings. We got DTS focus, DTS true bass, which is actually felt, DTS space, definition and center, all of them tweakable like this. And once again, you can actually hear them in the song once you tweak that. Now, as far as the headphones go, let's see what we're dealing with here. So they're pretty much the same as with the other Allview models, X1 sole, X2 sole, the same design. They're quite comfy, they have a wire that tangles, they also have a pretty big remote with 3 buttons, intelligently placed, and a microphone here. And they have an excellent volume, excellent sound quality and clarity, and the bass, especially with true bass, is perfect. So great headphones, very good noise isolation in your ear, and very comfy. The player supports hi-fi acoustics, and let's see if we got radio or not here. So let's check it out. If you don't find a radio app, there is no radio, and I cannot seem to find one. So let's look it up. No radio. Let's try FM. Okay, so this device doesn't support radio apparently. We're done with the headphones, an excellent experience as I said before, and now it's time to see how the device did in our test. And by test I mean our decibel meter test. Before that, I must remind you again that the player on board supports hi-fi music and also auto intelligent matching, upgraded to lossless. Basically you will upload the song to the device and it will make it lossless in theory. Okay, so at the back of the device we scored 86.9 decibels as shown by the decibel meter, while at the front 83.7 decibels. The highest score is the one that matters, so 86.9. We beat the LG AKA with its 86.4 decibels. We beat the Galaxy Note 4 with 85.6 decibels, and the Galaxy S6 Edge with its 85.3 decibels. We scored below the OnePlus One with its 90.5 decibels, below the ASUS ZenFone 2 with its 89.1 decibels, and below the Galaxy S6 with its 89 decibels. Overall, a nifty sound experience, no objections here, especially the headphones, and their presets are quite cool. Now it's time to talk about the display. Quad HD, 2560x1440 AMOLED, 6-inch, OGS technology, Gorilla Glass 3 protection, and 492 ppi pixel density. There is a video player in here, and let's see the usual test sample. Okay, so we have quite a few options here. First, we got DTS available. You can set it on or off. We also have a hi-fi mode that should be here somewhere. Anyway, you'll probably see it on a video that's actually a video, not a recorded video. So DTS, there's hi-fi, there's pop-up play, and there's the aspect option. Pop-up play lets you move the video around, resize it, and go back to the regular shape. And I have to say that I'm liking the frame rate very much here. Very good frame rate. Vivid colors, without oversaturation. Good brightness, good contrast, deep blacks, typical for an AMOLED. Crisp image. The resolution helps quite a bit. And wide viewing angles. It's a quite good AMOLED screen. However, the bezels are not very narrow, and once the screen is exposed to sun, it has some problems with the sun. The image isn't very visible, so sunlight visibility isn't very good. One thing that I notice here is that you gain more screen state thanks to the lack of virtual Android buttons. This device has pentile matrix pixels that are shown under the microscope here, and it's not very good under the sunlight. Why? Because it doesn't have a very high brightness. 320 lux is the max we achieved here. It's okay, but not flagship okay, not flagship material. At least we beat the LG G Flex 2 that scores 266 lux. We also beat the Lumia 1520 with its 315 lux, but we scored below the predecessor. The Allview X1 Xtreme actually got to 337 lux. We got beaten by the Asus Zenfone 2 barely, 323 lux, and by the HTC One M9, 362 lux. Also, even lower priced model beat us, like the Wiko Rainbow with 420 plus lux. In spite of this result, the phone feels a bit brighter in day-to-day use, and it should be brighter if it really claims the status of an Allview flagship. Now, as far as the settings are concerned, it's time to show you something. And this is the display section. However, I want to go back a bit to the sound, because we missed this option. This is the hi-fi music option with what I was trying to say earlier, automatic intelligent matching. Back to the display, we got brightness level, adaptive brightness, which basically optimizes the light depending on the surrounding light, economical backlight, adjusts backlight to save power, font size, available here, wallpaper, auto-rotate, sleep, LCD effect. This one shouldn't be tinkered with anyway. You can set it to neutral, cold color, or warm color. Usually it's good to leave it on neutral. And then we got daydream, skylight, and cast screen. Typical options for any phone out there. Overall, the screen is very crisp. I like the frame rate, but it could be brighter, that's for sure. Also, not very good in the sunlight. Now it's time for that huge monologue about the cameras. So, this 24 megapixel camera is actually the biggest resolution camera on a smartphone that we have tested here at gsnon.com this year. So yes, 24 megapixels, a record for us so far. It's the first time that an Allview phone is able to film in 4K. It has optical image stabilization, and the sensor that's doing wonders here is the OmniVision OV23850 or 23850. It measures about 0.5 inch. It was launched at the end of last year, and the same sensor brings face detection autofocus, at least on paper. It also can take pictures at a rate of 24 frames per second. The shots generated by it have 1.12 micron pixels, and in the mix you'll also find 6 lenses with an UV filter included and several other cool things. We also have sapphire glass protection for the camera, a dual tone flash, and Allview promises a focus here in just 0.2 seconds and photo taking in 0.4 seconds. And this model also brags about super zoom, basically digital zoom up to 3x without affecting the quality of the image, so without it dropping it. The front camera that you can see here is an 8 megapixel OmniVision OV8865 unit. It's from 2013. It provides 1.4 micron pixels, measures about 1/3 of an inch, the sensor, and does full HD video at 30 frames per second. And now you can trigger the camera by pressing the camera button, but it takes a longer while than expected, so if I'm pressing it once, try it again, it takes me quite a while. I have to press it really hard to trigger it while in standby mode. It's actually faster to press it twice, which triggers a different movement, so let's try it again, pressing it once. Nothing happens. If you press it twice, let's try that again. As you can see, if you press it twice, it takes 5 captures and then you choose the ideal one. And this made me think that I didn't press it hard enough, so I said before that you don't exactly get the feedback you want from pressing it, so let's try harder with the nail this time. Okay, finally we opened it up, that's the idea. What you said, it's fast, not exactly very fast here. However, the app itself, which I'm going to close for the sake of this test, the app itself opens up quite fast, as you can see. Okay, this is a typical user interface for an Allview phone with Lollipop. It's very colorful, slightly minimalistic, and pretty well balanced, and not exactly filled with useless options. So on the left side we got the settings right here. We got front mirror, anti-banding, 60Hz, 50Hz auto, guidelines, grid level meter or none, geotagging, countdown, resolution 24 megapixels in 4:3, 18 megapixels in 16:9 or 12 megapixels in 16:9, capture mode, touch shot or normal, sound, volume keys features, shortcut to the front camera, flash options, include auto, on or off. And then we got the modes, which are the interesting bit. We got face beauty, that triggers a bunch of DIY options like larger eyes, slimmer face, skin whitening and a smoother skin to remove your wrinkles. Then we got filters, pretty much speaks for itself, a bunch of filters to play with. Then we got the night mode, ideal for nighttime conditions. And then the pro mode, which is a bit of an extra compared to other Allview models out there. This pro mode brings the usual exposure options, ISO going up to 1600, white balance, and then there's the shutter speed going from the 30th part of a second to 12 seconds, and finally there's the focusing, manual, infinity and auto. All of them can be seen like this if you want to have them handy. That's the pro mode in a nutshell, very useful if you like to tweak your own shots. Then we got magic focus, take a shot, refocus, you know the drill, see into another devices. And then we got panorama, normal, take any time. Take any time is actually a collection of features. Basically you can take 5 shots, choose the best photo, choose the best face, create an object trail once a boy is skateboarding nearby, for example, do some motion blur or remove objects from the frame. Then we got HDR, speaks for itself. We got pick note that allows you to take a shot of, let's say, a notebook or a book, and you have a create PDF option, so you can turn that book into a PDF. And then we got the ultra pixel, and this is the interesting mode. You can create 120 megapixel shots. It sounds impressive. It offers a lot of detail. You can even print it on a huge 106 centimeter over 80 centimeter poster and frame it in your room. It uses interpolation. It takes 5 pictures and snaps them together. Then there's smart scene, which automatically detects, and pretty smartly, if you need HDR, night mode or things like that. So I'm going to leave it to normal and I'm going to go to the video because it has separate settings. Scene mode, night or auto, anti-banding, microphone on or off, exposure, anti-shake, auto white balance for now, geotagging and video quality that can be 4K, 1080p, 720p, 480p or lower. Okay, that's about it. We go back to the regular camera shooting. We got a fluid zoom here without quality drop, as you can see. And once you tap on the screen once, you can move the frames around to tweak the metering and exposure. Usually on other phones, you have to keep the screen pressed to trigger that. Here you don't, you just tap once, and instead of autofocus, you get to move those two frames. The focus is quite fast. The device doesn't have a problem from focusing on one point and then on another. and picture taking is also reasonably fast. However, while you're tempted to move the phone after taking the picture, you have to wait for 1 second or 1 millisecond, otherwise it will get blurred. So there's a bit of waiting time after the shot so it can get properly processed. That's the problem with a 24 megapixel shot. Okay, so the shots look pretty good, pretty nicely detailed, colors also look nice, but the gallery is where it's at. So let's go to the gallery. So as usual, we've taken many pics with this handset. We surpassed 100 pictures here with the Allview X2 Xtreme, the locally integrated version of the Gionee E8. I have to mention it was a cloudy day in mid-September. We started off with some indoor shots. The first one was a regular picture, and then we used that ultra pixel mode to create a very impressive shot, a 120 megapixel image that allows you to keep zooming and zooming and zooming to be impressed. Then we moved outside and took some shots with pretty good colors. And I have to say that in case you were impressed by the image before, you should know its resolution, 12,068 pixels over 9,456 pixels. So that's pretty impressive. Okay, so here we are, crisp landscape shots. Nice details when zooming in. These are regular shots, 24 megapixel shots, and you can clearly see these ducks here in spite of being many meters away. Okay, and this is the panorama. That is a bit of a letdown for me. It's 9088 pixels over 2432 pixels. It was taken using the phone in portrait mode, so the panorama was taken like this. I would have maybe liked to take it in landscape for a wider resolution if possible. Other than that, we also tried out the HDR features, so a regular shot. HDR shot, as you can see, it's better lit. And then we moved further, another HDR shot, once again good lighting. And then we took some close-up shots of this faucet here. Very nice texture of the metal and of the leaf. Keep in mind, we are zooming in a lot here, and still the quality remains pretty impressive, and the texture is also quite nice. Okay, other than that, a few more landscape shots, the usual shots of leaves in the fall, good colors, realistic colors, a crisp image, so a regular image, and then the ultra pixel shot, once again a 120 megapixel picture with incredible details that you can zoom into continuously and impressively. You should really enjoy that on the screen of your PC rather than on the phone. Some of the shots were blurry, only a few of them, let's say about 5%, so that's not a very bad thing. Good colors yet again. And we also have a selfie here. I have to say that I like in this selfie very much the attention paid to the background. Usually the background doesn't look very well in the selfies. This time it does look quite well. The texture of the skin is also nice. And it's one of the few selfie cameras that actually shows the hair in a more natural manner. Good colors again, and one of the best focus plays I've done with a handset ever. I've used the magic focus feature in order to focus on this knot and blur the background, and the result is simply stunning, as you can see. One of the best plays I had with focus once again. And again, playing with the focus, with magic focus, everything is blurry in the background and the foreground is totally highlighted by this function. Very impressive. One more landscape shot, colorful toys, and once again, very nice colors here, good exposure, white balance, and focus, absolutely no problem with the focus. Okay, getting close with the flowers this time, good colors, and here you can see me focusing on the bench rather than on the flowers and blurring the foreground. We played with HDR yet again. And we've reached an area where it was rather shadowy, so no sun here. And in spite of that, the camera handled the situation pretty well. Nice texture of these glossy toys. And once again, excellent level of detail. Of course, that's a perk of having a 24 megapixel camera. Good exposure, white balance, and very nice magic focus to play with. Yet another selfie. And here we play with that focus again. This time, I chose to focus on the flower first, and then on the background, just for the sake of an experiment with focus. Excellent level of detail in these shots, close-ups of flowers that we usually do. flowers of all colors, and all hues are excellently represented here. Okay, so this is the daytime capture. I was pretty much in awe of the close-up pictures of flowers. We got perfect macros, and from what I remember, I have to say that this camera is not very far from the Galaxy S6 when it comes to selfies, when it comes to focusing, and when it comes to close-ups, which is a pretty big compliment. It would be even closer to the Galaxy S6 if there weren't a few shots that were slightly blurred, let's say about 7 out of 100, which is not exactly a huge deal. And also, I think that I noticed that the camera is a bit too enthusiastic when it comes to setting up the exposure. That may be another flaw, let's say. From the predecessor, this is a step up. The colors look certainly better than they did on the Allview X1 Xtreme, that in itself was a very good camera phone. Now let's go to the nighttime capture. So first thing I noticed at night, a very powerful flash and excellent colors. Without the flash, well, things don't look so good. They get rather blurry and grainy, but with a flash, this was taken at 1 a.m. at night, and the flash does wonders. So regular shot, you can see that in lack of a good source of lighting, things appear to be blurry, grainy, and a bit yellowish. And the night mode helps a bit, but the flash helps much more. One more picture, and we also play with the night mode, so regular shot here and night mode here, helping the texture a bit. And here we try to play with that special shutter option, but obviously you're going to need a tripod or very steady hands, otherwise the image looks blurry. Good colors. Once again, if you activate the light source, the flash, you'll be very happy with the results. And I do mean happy. One of the most powerful flashes I've used on handsets that I've been testing over the past years. I would have to place the nighttime capture of the Allview X2 Xtreme somewhere in between the Galaxy Note 3 and Note 4 if you really want a comparison. Okay, so we're done with the camera, we're done with the photos, it's time to go to the videos and take them one by one. So this is the first Allview phone that films in 4K, and I have to say it has a pretty strange codec and format here. It's HVC1, HEVC, H2, H.265, a bit complicated, a bit unusual. For example, YouTube does not recognize this format, and many PC video players also do not, but the 4K capture looks stunning. I'm going to start off with Full HD MP4 video capture, which wasn't exactly very impressive. It's a bit shaky, a bit washed out, and we got a bitrate of 14 megabits per second. Once again, shaky and washed out. So that's why I'm going to go ahead and move to the second video, which is this one here. It has a bit of a wind problem and also a bit of an exposure problem. The focus is pretty much okay and the colors look good, but the exposure remains a problem. Okay, next shot. Let's see. This is the test of the image stabilization. Once again, a bit of a wind problem. At least there is no focus loss, so stabilization is quite okay. I've seen better stabilization, it's true, but considering the handset isn't exactly one of the giants, it handles the movement pretty well. Okay, and then comes the 4K video capture, looking absolutely stunning. So let's take it from the start. Fantastic details, very crisp image, and 36 megapixel per second bitrate, excellent colors. Very good exposure, white balance and focus, so no objection here. Sadly, you cannot upload this on YouTube for some reason, because the format isn't friendly enough with YouTube. Okay, we move even further for yet another video. In this one, we also tried out the zoom, and the whole movement of the hand while trying to zoom was a bit violent, and there's quite a bit of loss of detail here. As you can see, it gets a bit blurry when you're zooming in, but the colors remain okay and the image is reasonably crisp. And finally, one of the last videos during the daytime, if not the last, is this one here. Full HD, MP4 yet again, 30 frames per second, a bit washed out and a bit echoey as far as the acoustics go. And to draw the line here, I would have to say that in spite of the objections I'm having about the video capture, I feel that this camera films better than the LG G4, that was a big letdown, and it beats the HTC Desire 820, for example. It's below the Samsung Galaxy S5, for example, that filmed excellently, especially in 4K. However, you should remember that the 4K video capture here is also very good. And I have to mention that this model is not exactly a huge jump from the Allview X1 Xtreme filming, the predecessor of the phone. And now during the nighttime, well, that's a letdown. So you're going to see here a hazy blur, basically. Starts off nice, but somewhere in between, it starts to look like a VGA video in slow motion with a blurry image. And for some reason, the bitrate drops a lot, and I do mean a lot here, I don't understand why. It's about 5 mega per second, which is very, very low. And this is the same area without the flash on, also with a low bitrate. So while usually we could get as high as 17 mega per second or things like that, or 14 mega per second, here we only have 5 mega per second in bitrate, which is clearly noticed. The colors don't look okay. The image is a bit slow-mo, resolution not impressive, so nighttime video capture is a big no-no. Okay, other than that, I have to say that the 4K video capture was impressive, but the overall filming leaves a bit to be desired. I would have to say that this model surpasses its predecessor by about 15%, and I mean the X1 Xtreme. It's obviously below the Galaxy S6. But for example, it beats the Sony Xperia Z1, and in some conditions it can even be compared to the Sony Xperia Z3, for example in the daytime capture. Now if you want to do a bit of editing, you can press the edit button right here, and you'll be met with these filters. Also options like crop, straighten, rotate, mirror, exposure, vignette, contrast, shadows, highlight, vibrance, negative, edges and posterize, so a lot of options to tweak here. We go further and let's talk about the performance. This handset achieves a temperature of 36.6 degrees Celsius after playing the game Riptide GP2 for 15 minutes, so no, it does not overheat. As far as the web browser is concerned, I'm going to use the stock one that comes with the phone. You can also use Chrome, obviously. Let's load up gsndom.com, which loads reasonably fast, has a pretty fluid scrolling, and the text looks quite crisp on this Quad HD screen. As far as the keyboard goes, it's stock Lollipop affair, very well spaced, so no objection here. Now, as far as the phone goes, we got the stock dialer, if I'm not mistaken, and we got blacklist, speed dial and settings. And I should also mention that this is a dual SIM phone, and while you have 4G support on both slots, you can only use 4G on one at a time of these slots. And since we're also in the phone area, I have to say that the calls are quite loud, you got good signal and good clarity. Now it's time for the benchmarks, and let's go to the gallery. Okay, so benchmarks it is. I decided to compare the Allview X2 Xtreme with its predecessor, the X1 Xtreme, and with the Sony Xperia M5, because they share the same processor, the MediaTek Helio X10, and also with the LG G4, and finally with the Nexus 6, because they have a similar format. It's a 6-incher tablet after all. Okay, so this is a battle of the Helio X10 and 3GB of RAM, with the Snapdragon 800 of the predecessor and 3GB of RAM, versus the Helio X10 and 3GB of RAM of the Sony Xperia M5, and the Snapdragon 808 processor plus 3GB of RAM of the LG G4, and finally the Snapdragon 805 and 3GB of RAM of the Nexus 6. I'm going to start off with Quadrant. In this test, we scored 31,821 points. We beat the predecessor by 11,000 points, we beat the Xperia M5 that scored only 13,000 points, and we beat the LG G4 with its 17,000 points. the Nexus 6 was stuck at 13,000 points, at least in our test. In Antutu, a reasonably good score, which is 50,466, the predecessor had 34,269, the Xperia M5 33,963, and the LG G4 48,198. Nexus 6 50,243, so that's a close call. In Nenamark, we got to 59.5 frames per second, which is a bit lower than the predecessor that scored 61.4 frames per second, while the Xperia M5 from Sony scored 60.2, LG G4 60.1, and finally Nexus 6 59.4 frames per second. In Velamo, we had a score of 2460 in Chrome, while the X1 Xtreme had 2637, Xperia M5 1816, LG G4 3652, and Nexus 6 3677. Next up, there's 3D Mark. With a score of 16,755, we got beaten even by the predecessor with 17,125. Xperia M5 scored a very low 9,356 and the LG G4 18,228. Meanwhile, the Nexus 6 had 23,735. So, with 23,000, the Nexus 6 totally beat us. In GFX bench, which should be around here, we scored 27 frames per second in the T-Rex off-screen 1080p test, and we beat the X1 Xtreme by 5 frames per second. We beat the Xperia M5 and it's 17 frames per second, but we got beaten by the LG G4 and it's 32 frames per second, also by the Nexus 6 and it's 33.5 frames per second. Geekbench 3 is also here in the single core test. 911 in the multi-core test, very impressive 4630 score that hasn't been equaled by our rivals. The X1 Xtreme had 885 over 2381, while the Xperia M5 704 over 1930, if I'm not mistaken. The LG G4 1138 over 2996, and finally the Nexus 6 1077 over 3339. The speed test is also here, 15 Mbps in download, 20 in upload. X1 Xtreme had 14 and 22, Xperia M5 25 and 23, and LG G4 22 and 22, and finally Nexus 6 22 and 24. Browser Mark, reasonable result, 1483, this is the new browser mark, while the predecessor on the previous browser mark had 2397, not exactly relevant because it was a different version. Anyway, the Xperia M5 on the same version of browser mark 1159, and the LG G4 had 2093 as far as I know. Nexus 6 below this score, 1363. Sun Spider, here the lower the better, and our result was not very low, 1089. We got beaten by the X1 Xtreme with 601, we beat the Xperia M5 with its 1436, and also we managed to be defeated by the LG G4 with its 517 points, and by the Nexus 6 with its 827 points. The last test, Basemark X, 17,506 points, X1 Xtreme, the predecessor, had 15,000, Xperia M5 11,382, and the LG G4 had 25,188, while the Nexus 6 30,315, so they beat us. As you probably figured out by now, this model is not exactly a benchmark crusher. It wins 3 out of 11 battles of the one mentioned before. Compared to the predecessor, it wins 5 out of 11 battles. At least it beats the HTC One M9 and the LG G4, both are flagships. It beats them in a few tests, which is no small feat. Compared to the Xperia that has the same processor and the same amount of RAM, it wins 9 out of 11 tests, so that's got to count for something. In the meantime, this certainly does not suffer from lag. It runs a pretty much pure Lollipop. Aside from a few drop down and drop up customizations, it's pure Lollipop, and that can be felt through the lack of lag. Okay, and there's no lag when running games. As you can see, I've played quite a few games. There were a lot of icons there. Games with 3D graphics, complex particles, shadows, and things like that. And those include Riptide GP2, that was also used to test the temperature of the device. This phablet seems to be meant for gaming. It sits perfectly in your hands while gaming, as you can see, it has a perfect ratio to cover the whole screen. Nice water graphics, nice sunlight, good controls, good physics, and nice mechanics here. We got the water splash we wanted, so we're done with the gaming. Okay, this is it as far as the performance goes, benchmarks, gaming and all that, and now it's time to talk about the software. So we're running here on Android 5.1. As you can see, Android 5.1 Lollipop with a few customizations. In a big portion of it, it's stock. We got stock icons, as you can see, stock icons everywhere. If you keep the screen pressed, you'll be able to see the apps you can place on the screen, the widgets, some of them very good looking, and the effects you can apply to the screen. One of my favorite widgets is this one here that includes the weather and date and has this cute 3D-like motion once you move it around. Other than that, you can swipe down to view the notifications and you can swipe up to view the quick settings area. They are no longer unified. This is a customization coming from Allview. These quick settings can be expanded by pressing these three dots here. So you can see hidden quick settings that you can add here by dragging them if you want to move things around. And those include features like airplane mode, alarm, torch, fake call, calculator and camera that in the past were placed in the lock screen. Now if you go to the settings area, you'll see the usual features related to the connectivity, including NFC and the likes. We got sound and vibration, notification center, control center and something called security. Here we have a guest mode, password, screen lock and the fingerprint option. I have to mention that the fingerprint setup was quite fast. Fingerprint recognition is also fast and pretty precise, and I'm going to test it right now. So, screen is locked, and if I want to unlock it, I'm going to place my finger here, and I just unlocked it very fast, as you can see. I can use this unlocking for the encrypted files as well, which is pretty nice. Okay, now to turn that off. Security again, and fingerprint. I can access it using my finger. Remove the lock, and I want to show you that encryption feature I promised. So you're in the gallery, you reach this picture, and we have an encryption option right here. What happens when you press it, you will be sending that file to a special area of the phone. You can reach it via File Explorer, and there you can decrypt it or keep it hidden forever. There's also a special option that encrypts the whole phone in case you want to go secret agent mode. So security and encrypt phone. Be very careful with this feature if you're not sure what you're doing, and it takes quite a while to encrypt everything. Okay, we move further from the security. Once again, very precise and very fast fingerprint scanner. Then we got location, power management and advanced settings. Here we got smart gestures. They're the usual ones, like picking up the phone close to the ear to contact the number, smart answer, pick up the phone to answer automatically, or double click to wake, or smart vibration reminder, smart bright screen, and some touchless features I haven't seen in a while. I remember playing with them on the Galaxy S4, then they quickly became obsolete. So here we go. Pick up the phone by waving your hand, or at least trying to. Almost there, you have a password to enter. And let's try it again. Feel like an idiot for doing this over and over again and doesn't seem to recognize it. Let's see if we actually activated it or not. Smart gestures, and they're all checked out. Wake up the phone by waving the palm over the phone in sleep mode. So let's try it again, but before that I want to remove that screen lock that I find to be annoying. Okay, so third time's the charm, so Now let's try the other features, like navigating in the interface. As you can see, now it works. And I'm guessing in the gallery it also works. Not very responsive, interprets some of the gestures as one thing. Here we go. And now I want to try one more time. Nope, doesn't want to. So, as you can see, some of the gestures work, some don't. Off camera, they worked, obviously. So those are the advanced settings and smart gestures you get to play with here. You got touchless unlock, touchless video control and all that. Then we got a suspend option, that little annoying button that gives you an extra set of virtual buttons if you don't like the standard ones. And I don't like this feature very much, I find it to be pretty annoying. Then we get LED light settings, storage options, scheduled on off, power on off, language and input, backup and reset, permission of apps. And one thing I forgot to show you is the multitasking that's done via the usual Lollipop carousel with a lot of apps opened up here. Now we also have these NFC tags that have been bundled with the phone, and once you activate NFC you can use each of them for a home profile, car profile and all that. So I'm going to try that right now. Connectivity, NFC, on. And once you touch it with this little blue tag, it sensed it and I can complete it using this option. And it's going to open this, open the Wi-Fi and customize things. I can touch it with another tag and collect a new tag and memorize it as office and other situations. So that's NFC in a nutshell here. Well, in that part of the review where we analyze the pre-installed apps list, I have to say that this phone does not suffer from bloatware, which is always a good thing. So we got Bitdefender Mobile Security, we got the browser, calculator, we got the calendar. Looking mighty fine, I might add, and from what I can see, it's been personalized by Allview, so it's not the stock Lollipop one. We got the camera, we got Chameleon, and Chameleon, what it does is that it creates a new theme for you to play with by using the colors it senses around you. So if it sees yellow, it creates a yellow theme. If it sees blue or gray, it creates a theme like that. Then you can preview it and use it on your desktop, for example. Other than that, we got Chrome, Clock, Compass, Contacts, Drive, and Email, Facebook, File Explorer, Gallery, Gmail, Google, Google Plus, Hangouts, Maps, now with transit directions. And then we got Messaging, Music, Notes, your typical note-taking application, pretty basic and allowing you to attach a voice recording, location or alarm. Then we have Phone, Photos, Play Books, Play Games, Play Music, Play Newsstand and Play Store, Self-Care, Settings, Sound Recorder and System Manager. That's quite useful if you want to clean up your memory, your cache, manage the apps, manage the power, data traffic, and there's even an Echo mode here if you really want to save the planet. Then we got System Update, Theme Park, basically your theme app, Torch, Video, Voice Search, and finally the Weather. Okay, so this is it as far as the handset is concerned. That's the full review. You've seen the multitasking, you've seen the NFC, you've seen the camera, and now it's time for the pros and cons. On the pro side, obviously, the solid design. It's a very solid and massive phablet, sits well in the hand for the gaming. It has lots of storage, and I find that impressive. Aside from the 64GB, a microSD is also thrown in. It's less grossy than the predecessor, the X1 Xtreme. It has pretty good audio, actually great audio. The screen is very vivid, it has excellent colors as you saw throughout the review, and I have to say that the camera has a great focus feature, also nice colors in the shots we've taken, nice macros, nice selfies, very powerful flash, and the 4K video is one of the best I've seen on all smartphones. The lack of bloatware is a plus, the fast fingerprint scanner too, encryption features, and finally those 120 megapixel shots created by interpolation are nice too. Of course, this is not a perfect phone, so in the cons area we have some things to mention, like the fact this phone may feel too massive for some people, and I have to say that the battery is a bit underwhelming. I expected about 8 or 9 hours, I only got 6 hours from it. The screen could be a bit, only a bit brighter. Sunlight behavior of the screen could also be better, and the camera button is not exactly comfy, as you saw in the video review. Also, video capture is not of the high quality, and I mean the Full HD one, not the 4K one, and I do not like this swipe up thingy. I would have preferred to have both options here, both the quick settings and notifications, so I wouldn't have to swipe up like this. Anyway, it's a question of preferences. And now the grades, so I'm going to go ahead and give this handset a grade of 9 for the design, and also a grade of 8.5 out of 10 for the hardware. Here it lost points for the video capture, the battery, and the screen with its sunlight behavior. And finally, for the OS and UI, not many objections, not many at all, 9.7 out of 10. The final grade for this phone from gsandon.com is 9.06 out of 10. It's a big phone for people who play big. I like the encryption features, I like the selfies, I also like the main camera when it comes to taking pictures. The display colors are great. This is an excellent gaming phone. It does not overheat, it does not have bloatware, it's pretty close to stock Android, and it's great for gaming, working and pictures, especially if you actually need that encryption feature that can be unlocked by pressing this. Too bad for the battery, otherwise it's basically a perfect package. So 9.06 out of 10 from gsandon.com. Bye bye.